The following is a special presentation of Pens TV.
Life is one big ritual, a series of events, patterns of behavior, mirrored on a daily basis. Some would call it a grind. Hockey players call it a labor of love.
Do what it takes to help your team win. Guys have different routines, different ways they walk into the rink.
It's something that you do so many times a year, so it becomes natural to you to prepare yourself, same routine every day. And by the time you get to the arena, it's just business as usual.
Hockey is a business, and nothing can disrupt that routine quite like the trade deadline.
Some guys are probably a little anxious as to what could happen, and as a manager, and I know our staff, we're anxious as well. We don't know what's going to happen either, because some of these things come down the last minute, as we know, and you don't know what's going to transpire. So I think it's a little nerve-wracking for both players and managers.
You try not to let it get to you, you know, it's part of the job, and you take it day by day.
I think everyone has a little bit of that uneasiness about what the deadline might bring.
Certainly in Pittsburgh, guys don't want to go anywhere else. We have a winning team, great players, great fans. It's a good city to live in. I don't think one guy in this locker room want to leave.
With the deadline looming, the Penguins worked off some stress before leaving for Philly. It was mid-February. Pittsburgh had lost four of its last seven and dropped to fourth place in the Atlantic Division. The Penguins were headed down the home stretch and about to find out who they really were.
The game in Philly for us was a big game, knowing we played them four more times, knowing we hadn't beat them yet, knowing we hadn't won in Philly.
We were chasing them. I don't know how many points we were back, but it's a big game to, you know, gain some ground on them and answer after a couple losses against them.
The Penguins hadn't won in Philly in nearly a year. And with 25 games left in the regular season, they needed to win this one to stay in the division race.
Here's Puck with it, shooting, he scores! Matt Puck gets the first goal, and the Penguins take a 1-0 lead in Philadelphia. Yager with Pierre, Yager pulls out, fires, scores! The Flyers enjoying a 4-on-3 now. Yager again, holds, fires, scores!
We gave up a power play goal in that game in the first period to Yager. And then to face with the penalties we had in the second period with a 5-on-4.
Stahl, short-handed. Stahl, fires, scores! What a shot by Stahl! And the Penguins tie the game with a short-handed goal.
Then we go down 5-on-3. Really in a tough spot in that game. We needed to come up big. Not only did we come up big, we get almost a never-happy situation with a 5-on-3.
That 5-on-3 was huge. I was actually sitting in a box, so as you're sitting in there, you don't want the momentum to switch on the other side.
And now Tiemann mishandles the puck, and Matt Cook in a foot race. He'll win it easily. Cook to the goal. Scores! Matt Cook with his second goal of the game.
And a 3-on-5 goal by Matt Cook.
I felt a little better in the penalty box there, seeing these guys score.
So to come out of that penalty situation, which was one that really could have put the game in Philly's favor, leading 3-2 was just a huge effort to come up with those two goals and the kills.
Execution on the penalty kill led to the first win over the Flyers this season. And it's not the first time it's made a difference. The Penguins only allowed two power play goals the entire month of February.
The penalty kill has to step over the boards and get the job done, and that's what they have instilled in our team, and you need that.
We got a lot of guys that go over the boards that can kill penalties. Anyone that's out there is gonna put their face in front of the puck just to block it.
I think it's a system, it's also the players that we employ that take great pride in their penalty kill and their stats, and of course your goaltender's gotta be your best penalty killer, as they say.
It's an old cliche, your goaltender has to be your best penalty killer, and goaltending's been unbelievable for us.
Between that and of course our power play this year has been in the top five. We've got the best special teams combined in the league right now.
But the Penguins wanted to be the best team in the league. After a letdown in Buffalo, the best team in the Eastern Conference came to town.
Coming back with the challenge of playing the Rangers, who are 10 points ahead of us in the standings, who clearly we haven't done real well. We haven't beaten them in this building yet at all. It was a really big game for us, and I know a lot of guys felt like they needed to step up in that game.
We know we had 3 games left against the Rangers, and if we had any hope of catching them by the end of the season here, we needed to win all 3, and we played one of our best games of the year.
Picked up by Malkin. He's behind the defense. Malkin in on Lundqvist. He scores! He burns Lundqvist on the backhand to make it 1-0. Sullivan, he fires. Scores! And Sullivan does pick up his first power play goal in 24 games.
Special teams and goaltending won the game for Pittsburgh.
Here come the Rangers. Anisimov with a shot. Fleury gloves the puck and holds on to it.
Marc-Andre Fleury held on for the shutout, the 22nd of his career, tying him with Tom Barrasso for the most in franchise history.
Flower obviously has been playing sick and keeping us in the games, and it was a huge win for us and I think a big confidence booster.
We're probably going to look back at the game that put us on the right track.
My mindset really hasn't changed that much in this hockey team, beating the Rangers in Philly. It helps solidify your feeling about your team. You know, when we lost 6 in a row earlier in the year, I still said that I liked our team.
Well, it's always important to play well against the top teams, and those 2 games were a perfect example to go into Philly and to win that game there, which is always a tough place to play, and win against the top team in the East at the time. It did a lot for our team, for our confidence, and knowing that we can play against anybody in the league.
Management was happy with the roster, content that this team, as currently assembled, needed no repair. A ringing endorsement for the players, and that was the only ringing they wanted to hear.
I know, just speaking to a few of our players, when the phone rings on deadline day, the prominent thought in their mind is, where am I going? Should I just get traded?
I got a call at about 20 to 3 from a 412 number, so I was in the grocery store with the wife, and it was a my heart kind of dropped for a second there, but it was just my car was ready, so it some relief there.
Relief would be coming, just not in terms of a quick fix.
We didn't do anything at the deadline. You know, for a good portion of the year, we led the league in man games lost due to injury, and now we're starting to get healthy, it seems, and so we're happy with our team as it was at the trade deadline and hope to get Sid back at some point.
We like our room. This is the team that's going to get it done. It's not going to be anyone coming in. It's not going to be outside help.
Oh, it's awesome. For them to keep everyone here and not bring anyone in shows a lot. They're confident in the team we got here, and I think everyone in the dressing room is.
It feels great. The chemistry is here. The management feels comfortable in the team we have. They're confident in the guys in this locker room. And when you have a guy like Sidney Crosby that probably will come back right after the trade deadline, it's always a big plus.
This has been a presentation of Pens TV.